question of how cultural attitudes and gender roles affect clean cooking adoption in Nigeria and elsewhere in Africa. I'm usually careful not to generalize about, you know, culture being a barrier to, you know, the uptake of presumably good technologies or practices like clean cooking. That said, however, there is a clear gender dimension to clean cooking access. Cooking is traditionally seen as women's unpaid work, and for that reason, it does tend to receive low policy and market attention. So a lot of potential interventions that could have been maybe improved upon just haven't received the kind of attention that it might otherwise have. But more broadly on the issue of gender, you know, we've had some studies suggest that in actual fact, the ultimate solution to the clean cooking conundrum would actually be to have more women work in decent jobs outside the home, because what really drives the use of especially solid biomass fuels, fuel wood in rural areas, is the fact that you have women who go to gather it freely, gather fuel wood freely, free of economic costs from forests and things. Meanwhile, if the opportunity cost of them using that time to gather fuel wood was much higher, if they were to be losing an income by doing that, then the use of those fuels would reduce, and of course they would have more resources to purchase clean cooking fuels on the other hand.
In terms of the financing solutions that have worked,
in other countries that are facing economic challenges to similar to Nigeria, there is this thesis by Michael Aikling and colleagues in their 2018 book, Escaping the Energy Poverty Trap, that actually, you know, they actually demonstrate quite convincingly that the key elements required for this kind of broad transition would be unwavering political will and associated government funding. This has been the case in countries as diverse as China, Vietnam, and then closer home to Africa, we have South Africa and Ghana, where considerable progress has been achieved in clean cooking and broader energy access within relatively short periods of time. The sad reality is that many African countries, including Nigeria, are yet to make that level of public commitment. And so the effect of that has been that the little strides that have been made in the sector have been largely due to individual, private, and donor capital. On the issue of how Nigeria's experience with clean cooking could inform global climate justice discussions, a key gap in the current climate finance architecture globally is that negotiations are mainly conducted at the national level. The downside to that is it's not clear exactly how much of the funding that is generated in the process, how much of that actually trickles down to the communities that really need the clean cooking interventions, or if they trickle down in the format or in the form that they are actually needed. And so my kind of response to this would be, we need collectively to prioritize a model so that basically engenders early identification of community level needs and priorities very, very early in the decision making, negotiation, deal making process. And that will enable the identification of the priorities and needs of communities, but also importantly, it will help to make national governments more accountable to citizens, national and subnational governments, including local governments, more accountable to citizens for the outcomes of the climate finance and clean cooking programs that are eventually implemented. Thank you.